So welcome all. Welcome to the lecture 9 of the design analysis of algorithm. In this session, we are going to continue our discussion on the matroids. You will be seeing that a particular application of this matroid that is using a graphical matroid, and the application is called the minimum spanning tree. So let us start our discussion. I would briefly go through that what we have done in the last class. So we have seen that matroid is actually matroid presents a theory for some of the situation into the greedy algorithm that actually arises. And if so, we can say that some problem is actually, we can say that it is something like matroid. So we will be seeing that there are ingredient properties of the matroid greedy algorithm are already available into the greedy this matroid. So we need not to prove anything. If we can model the things into the matroid method, so we can say that everything is fine and therefore we will be able to get the right solution. You know that into the greedy methods, we are not guaranteed to have the best solution, because it takes a locally optimal solution in the hope that it would get the global solution. But sometimes it may not be possible. But if you somehow link your things into this matroid framework, we would be seeing later that all these properties are satisfied, and therefore you would be definitely going to get the right answer, right solution. Okay, so what was the matroid? We have seen in the last class that matroid is nothing more than this. There are few properties are there. So we have seen that there are two specific set. It is a tuple. We have seen that matroid is a tuple that contains S and I, these two things, where S is a finite set. Okay, S is only a set. And I is another set that is defined using properties. S is provided to you as an item. You can tell that these items are there into S because it's a finite set. But I could be a very large set, exponentially large set, and the contents of the I are actually not provided to you. But we have seen that two properties are there, hereditary property and the hereditary property and the exchange property. These two properties belongs. What is the hereditary property? That in the I, if you find out any set A, so all the subsets of the B, if there is A that is a subset of B, so A is also going to belong to I. Means if there is a something you find out that it belongs to I, then all the subsets would also belong to that thing. And what is the exchange property? Exchange property says that there is say A inside the I and B inside the I. Two things if you can find out, and you see that B, size of B is actually greater than size of A, then it says that there exists some X inside the B. You can pick some item from B and you can add that item to A, and you add that item to A, and that A becomes, then you can make A dash is equal to A union this X, and this would also belongs to I. This would also belongs to I. So exchange property says that you can find out an item that you can always insert, and then by this you get an extension. Okay, we say that X is extending A. X is extending A. Okay. All right. So then we have seen in the last class that there is a notion called the graphic matroid. And what is the graphic matroid? It is defined on the graph. So you know that what is the graph? There are some nodes, and on that node there are some edges. So how the graphic matroid is defined? It says that I am going to define this. If you provide me a G and I, a graph as a set of V and E, V for vertices and E for edges. So what would be the V? That what are the A, B, C, D, dot, dot, what are the vertices? If I say that this is A, this is B, this is C, this is D, this is E, this is F. And what is the edges? Edges is, FA is S. So I can say that FA, AB is S, AB, dot, dot, dot. I can put all the edges into this particular set. The two sets, you know that graph is defined using two sets, set of vertices and set of edges. And if you define the graph in this way, then you can define the matroid in this way, that, and this matroid would be called the graphical matroid because it is defined over the graph. So here, what is the, because you know that into matroid we have to define two things, S and I. What is S? S is E. All the edges you put into the S. Okay. And what is I? So all these things I have done in the last class, so I'm going a bit fast. If you have any question, you may ask. So I, what is I? I is defined using property. You know that, the using property. And the property is this, that if you find out any subset of the edges that is acyclic, then it is inside the I. So what is inside the I? Acyclic subset of S. Okay, so A is a subset of E, a subset of edges you have selected, and if A is acyclic, then it is inside this I. So we have seen that if a cyclic subset of this particular edges is taken, means what? Means I am selecting few things such that there is no, for example, I have selected this. What else I can select? I'm not going to the maximum. So these things are selected. If I select these things, so it is going to make a forest. Okay, it is going to make a forest. Forest means multiple trees. Tree means single tree. There are multiple trees. So how many trees are there? Can you tell me? So you can say that this is the one tree. This is the one tree. This is the second tree. This is the third tree. Three trees are there. How many trees are there? Three trees are there. Now it is our responsibility to show that actually it is a matroid, and if it is a matroid, it should have the properties. What are the properties? These three properties you have to show me that all these properties are there. So first property, that S is finite, need not to be shown, because you know that because number of edges is finite, or S is the set of number of edges, so definitely it is going to be finite. So no need to worry about this. This is satisfied. Okay, any questions on that? If we want to show the hereditary property, means we want to prove that if there is some, for example, this set is taken. Let's assume that this example is taken. Okay. So if I take any subset of that, subset of this means I'm going to delete something. Let's assume that I delete this. If I delete this, any one of them, then that would be a subset. Multiple also would be a subset. So would that particular set would also be inside I or not? It would also be inside I, because it would also be acyclic. If you delete something, that would also be acyclic. So therefore, because of this definition, that would also be inside the I. So this property is satisfied. Hereditary property is satisfied. Any question on that? The third property is a tricky one. That says that, what is the third property? Let me just remove this and tell you once again. Okay, let me clear the screen. Cut. Okay, so the third property is a tricky one. It says, what is the third property? Exchange property. It is an exchange property. It says that if you find out two things where there is one is of the larger size, what do we mean by this? That this was the, let's assume this was the this was the set of edges, and I picked some. For example, these edges I have picked, okay, and here into the next example I may be picking something else. Okay, I may be picking something else, this, and I may be picking this and 1, 2, 3, 4. Here there are four edges. Okay, here there are only two edges. Two edges. So this third property says that I can find something into some edge into this particular set. I can find out something in this particular set such that I can insert that thing over here. Okay, only one. I am not going to talk about many. I'm talking about one. I can find out that I can put it here. So my argument in the last class was this, that there exist. I'm telling that there exist an is in B. Let me call it A. Okay, because the size of A should be less than size of B. I say that there exists an A in B such that it is going to connect. That it is going to connect two trees. Okay, but it means it starts from one tree and goes to another tree. So there exists an is. So how can you prove that it is always true? So point is this, that here I was trying to give you the observation. Let's assume that here one tree is this, another tree is here, let's assume, another tree is here, let's assume these trees are there. Okay, so if you want that this condition is violated, if you want to violate this condition, you say that no, this is not true. You want to say that this is not true, then all the things which are here, all the things which are there inside B, you have to put in these trees only. Okay, then only it would not connect. If you pick it and put it here, then it would not connect. So my thinks is actually this, you can say that it is not true. Okay, so I can pick this, put somewhere. I can pick this, put here. I can pick this, put here. But please note, I can, this is a tree, this is a tree. And in a tree, how many nodes are there? Because if this contains, say, five nodes, so you can only pick five nodes and you may connect over here. If this contains four trees, four edges, so you from here you can pick the four edges over here. If this particular tree contains two edges, so from here you can put two things and put it here. When everything is full, but after that, if you pick anything from here, but after doing this, if you pick anything and try to put it here, you cannot put in inside here, because if you are putting inside, then what would happen? It would become a size circle. Okay, and you know that the number of item here into the B are actually larger than the number of item into the A. So definitely you would be getting one thing over here that you have to put it here in such a way so that it is going from one two to n, one tree to another. In the same tree you cannot put, because then it would become a cycle. It would become a cycle. So you to put it here, there would be something that is going to be from one tree to another. And my point is, if you put that thing into this particular A, if you put that particular X, I'm going to call that particular is that X. If I'm going to put that S over here, what would happen? That it is also not going to form a cycle, because two trees are going to be connected, then it is not going to form any, where two different trees are there. Na? So if I'm going to draw S between them, they are not going to form any. They are not going to form any cycle. So definitely I can find a x. Okay, so this is what the third property is, that I can find out a x inside B. I can find out a x inside B. X belongs to B, that if I can that I can put into A, and A can be extended. So using the same logic, you can again extend it. You can extend it. You can again extend it, and you can go it to the maximum. So we have seen in the last class that all these three properties are actually satisfied, and this X that actually we have used is called, we call it that X extends A, and this X is coming from where? It is coming from B. Any questions on that? We have did it in the last class, and is it clear till now? Can you write yes? All these things we have covered in the last class. Any question till now? Ayush, Igna, any questions on that? No. Okay, great. So in this setting, you may by yourself can you can think that if inside I, if I find something, if I find some set that there is some A that belongs to A, belongs to I, so definitely I can extend it to A dash. So A would also be there, A dash would also be there. Okay, because they satisfy the property, both would be there. So for this A, I can find out some A dash that has a higher, larger size. Then from A dash, I can increase it one more, and I can tell that I have actually something exists that has a size of A double dash. From A double dash, I can increase something to A triple dash, and I can keep increasing until what? Until what? Until I find out some other set. Until I fail to find something that another set that is actually having the size larger than this particular thing. If I don't, if even if I have a one B, then I can extend it. So you may think that there would be a limit. After that, I cannot extend it. Okay. So that particular set would be called what? Maximal independent set. So any problem on that? It is a definition. What is the maximal independent set? Achha, let me tell you here very, very categorically that when I say that independent set means what? Okay. I am going to use this word for the historical region, and there is no meaning of independent here. Independent only mean here that this particular set belongs to I. That's it. Nothing more than this. Okay. So this is a misnomer here, but we are using multiple time here because of the historical region. The person who has proposed it, he was using some problem that are actually related to finding out the independent set. So that's why we are also using independent here. Independence means what? As I'm again telling that it's a misnomer, it means that the item belongs to this particular set. Make sense? Don't get confused. So maximal independent set means what here? That I have something that now I cannot increase the size. This is the maximal size. Okay, the items which are there inside the I, there is a some maximum size, and after that I cannot increase the size. Okay, if there is some set which cannot be extended, I say that the size of that thing is a maximal, and that particular set is a maximal independent set. So whether this is clear, hope it is very simple, so everybody would be okay with that. Yeah, okay. So then this particular thing is very very simple. Okay, I just wanted to tell you that all the maximal independent set have the same size. So now you will be thinking that I has a maximal independent set. Say, I should say in this way, I have a maximum independent set. Let's assume that A is maximal independent set, and B is also maximal independent set, C is also maximal independent set, D is also maximal independent set. So all the subsets of A, B, C, D are also there inside the I, you know this. But this is the maximum size, okay? So all the maximal independent sets have the same size. They are all the same size. If you have a maximal independent set, they have the same size. Why? Because of the simple reason that let's assume that B and A both are, let's assume that A and B are the maximal independent set, and the size of B is greater than size of A. Then I can find out AX inside the B that I can add over here, and I can make A to the I dash. Then the size of A increases. So how come it was maximal? Because there was something that can extend it. So because of this contradiction, we can say that all the maximal independent set have the same size. Make sense? Yes? Yes? Okay? Yeah. Okay, so this is nothing more than this, that there is a contradiction that if then we can find out some, there exists X that can extend it. Then there comes a very simple concept that tells that something is called the weighted metroids, okay? And weighted metroids is only this thing that you know that metroid has only two things, S and I, and we also define something called W. We can define the W all weights. And weight could be, for example, in our case, when we have a graph, when we have a nodes and we have a graph, then what is S? S contains edges. Okay, so you know that into the general setting we have is have a weight 3, 2, 1, 5, 6. Okay, is have the weight. So we can also define another function W that if you provide a edge to this, it could tell that what is the weight of that particular thing. Okay, so for example, if I say that A, B, C, D, E, F, and I ask what is the EF, what is the weight of EF? So you would be telling 3. Can you tell me what is the weight of AC? What is the weight of AC? Can you see? 5. Because 5 is written over there. Okay, so you can find out this. Okay, from this particular table, 4 and 5, whatever you wish. Okay. From this side it looks 4 and from this side it looks 5. Okay, interesting. Okay, now you are right. Okay. So everybody understand that what is the weight? So weighted metroid, what is the weighted metroid? Again, I have introduced one more concept that there is some weight. So for the weighted metroid, you know that inside the I, what is there? There are some subsets of S. So if I pick a subset of pick A from the I, and try to find out that what is the weight of A. Till now we have only talked about that what is the weight of an is. So you can find out that for all the edges which are there inside the A, you find out what is the summation of W. Make sense? Nothing very fancy. You know that if you want to, on a particular set, if you want to find out the weight, so you individual all the individual things, you find out the summation. So WA is defined in this way, and very important thing is this, that now a small thing I wanted to discuss with you. Let's assume that you have an array which has contained item, for example, 5, 9, 3, 2, 1, 8. Let's assume that these items are there, and there is a location also associated. I say that first location, second, third, fourth, fifth, sixth. Let's assume that you have an algorithm, okay, algorithm A. In this algorithm, if you provide this particular array, it would tell you what is the location of maximum item. It tells you the location of the maximum item. Okay, problem is clear to you? I have an algorithm A that if I feed this thing here, it would tell me what is the location of the maximum item, or the what is the maximum item. So what is the answer in this particular case? If I provide this array, what is the answer? What is the location of maximum item? 2. Okay. Now I'm going to give you a question. I want minimum item of this particular area, location of the minimum item. And I want to use this algorithm only. Can I do this? No. How can I use this? This tell me the maximum item. Yes or no? No. Clear, na? This I cannot use it. Yes. Do you understand the problem? I want to find out the minimum item, and this algorithm tells me the maximum item. Can I use this algorithm? Yes or no? Can I use this? Yes or no? Ayush is perfectly right. He is telling that multiply all the number with the minus 1 and then supply to this particular algorithm and find out that what is the location of the maximum item. So this would be the minimum item for our case. So this is one way, but let's assume that this algorithm takes only all the, again, I'm going to change the problem, that if only it takes positive item, then there is no problem. Here you find out what is the maximum item. Let's assume that maximum, here the maximum item is 9. You take any number out larger than this, for example, 100. And most of the time, this number is known to you, because into the computer science, we know that what is the maximum value possible in a storage space. So you need not to actually search for all the items, that what is the maximum item. You know that what is the maximum item. And you tell that the maximum item, if that particular maximum item is W0, you say that W0 minus E is weights. Okay. If W0 minus A, if you convert your problem into this particular way, that you say that I'm going to define a new function W dash that is some W0 minus WE. And where W is a large number, sufficiently large number, then this maximization problem can be converted to the minimization problem. Make sense? Okay. So the same thing is written over here, that W dash of A, if you want to find out that what is a W dash, so you know that this is what the definition is. W dash for all the A's is summation of this. And using this formula, because we have changed this formula, we change it W0 minus WE. Okay, summation term goes inside, and this is the summation of V minus 1, because we know that how many edges it has. If it is a maximal set, then it would be having minus 1. So there is a constant number that is W0 multiplied by V minus E, and then the summation is actually subtracted over here. And this quantity is W of A, because this is by your definition. So we say that there is a constant term. There is a this particular term is a constant term. We say there is a large constant minus W of A. Okay. So if you find out the minimum of this, then maximize this quantity. Okay. So we can see that the minimization can be seen as a maximization problem if you can do this kind of small change into the weights. Make sense? Okay, that was not important. So now we wanted to discuss with you that there is something called minimum spanning tree. And first, let us talk about the spanning tree. So let's assume that I have a graph. Okay, I have a graph. Okay, and there is some connections. Okay, there is some connections, and the connections are maybe weights are 5, 2, 9, 3, 1, 2, 5, 8, 15. To make them in the interest of making everything different, I can write like this. So let's assume that this is the graph. And then if I want to make a tree out of that, what is tree? Everybody knows that, what is tree? If I want to find out tree means you draw something, everything is connected. So you know that these things are connected. This is the tree. Makes sense? All the nodes are connected. And there is no cycle. There is no cycle. If there is no cycle, all the nodes are connected, then it would be a tree. Tree does not have the cycle. That's it. Tree does not have a cycle. Makes sense? Tree does not have a cycle. What is a spanning tree? A spanning tree means connecting all the nodes. Spanning means connecting all the nodes. All the nodes. Here our assumption is this, that graph is, number of components in graph is only one. Because if number of components is already two, then you cannot create the edges by yourself. Okay, so a spanning tree, whether this problem is clear to you, a spanning tree problem is clear to everybody. So in this spanning tree, if I say that, then the solution is A. Okay, what is the A? Let me say is A, B, C, D, E, F. The solution is AF, AF, AB, BC, BE, and DC. This is what the solution is. Okay. Can you tell me what is the weight of A? Can you find out what is the weight of A? Just tell me that I'm not going to find out the solution. Can you tell me what is the weight of A? Find out, tell me. Tell me, what is that value? 8 plus 5 plus 9 plus, I have not written a number over there. So you take, let's assume that, let's you take 7 here. Okay. So what is the summation? Oh my God, you're not writing. 8 plus 5 plus 7 plus 9 plus 1. Okay, this is what the value, okay. And, but there could be other solution also. So I can tell that instead of this, I can take this. For example, this. And this can also be the solution. I can say that this is the solution B. What is the summation of, what is the weight of this? Let me just find out the weight. What is the weight for this? 2 plus 7 plus 3 plus 12 plus 15. What was this number? Somebody was telling 30. I'm not finding out the summation. What is this value? Can you give me what is the number? Let's assume it is 35. Okay, 39. Okay, I'm not finding out the solution. Let's assume that it is 39. So if you know that spanning tree problem, for the spanning tree problem, multiple solutions are possible. If multiple solutions are possible, then we can say that this solution is more favorable as compared to this one. One is more better than the other. We can tell like that. Okay. Based on the weights, we can tell that this particular thing is better. So we want that minimum total length. Total length should be minimum. We can tell that the solution which has the total length minimum is going to be the better. So it is like finding maximal independent set, because maximal independent set, why? Into the graphical matrix, because you know that if the graph is there, so maximal independent set would connect all the nodes. Why? Because if something is not connected, then I can connect it. Okay, so till there is no cycle, so it is using the same definition of graphical matrix. Make sense? Into the graphical matrix, we also try to find out a largest set that does not contain any loop. So, and the tree also does not have the loop. So the similar problem is this. And here, but however, we need a notion of weight, and we need the total minimum total weight we want to find out. So I'm going to give you an algorithm that is called, I'm going to call it greedy algorithm. And this algorithm is applied to things. What is the matroid and what is the weight? what are the weights. The algorithm goes in this way. Achha, let me also discuss quickly that if you have, for example, if you have n number of nodes, okay, if n number of nodes, so how many edges you have, order of n square, okay, and how many nodes would be in your solution, n minus 1, because if n number of nodes are there, n minus 1 values would be there inside your solution, because in the tree, if you want to make the tree, n minus 1 edges, you only you can draw n minus 1 edges. So the total number of solution is n square n minus 1. This is exponential number, very large number, as compared to if you want to solve this particular problem into the brute force way, means generate all the possible things and then try to find out the solution, it is going to take the exponential time. So this problem is not that easy. Okay, so how can we find out the efficient solution? So one efficient solution I am going to discuss right now, and the solution is this, that I am going to say that I would take a set, I would create an answer set as a phi. Initially there is nothing in that, and I would sort all the s, because m has two things, s and I. Here the edges are there, I am going to sort them into the decrease non increasing order, means the highest item first, into decrease in the order of weight, decreasing order of the weights, okay, non increasing, we can also say that non increasing, okay, non increasing order of this. Then what I am going to take, that I would pick the first item, because all the edges are there into S, I would pick the first item. See the algorithm. For x belongs to m dot s, taken in order, okay, this order that we have just sorted. What I'm going to say, that if A union x belongs to m dot I, means if I put that item into my set A and it is not creating a cycle, if I'm going to put A have some edges, and new as that I have find out, I am going to put inside and it is not going to form any loop, or then only it would be inside the m dot I. Then what I say, that A is equal to A union X, means I am going to include that particular item in my set. So first item, second item, third item, one by one increasing, I am including all the item, and then I am done, return A. This is what my answer is. So can you analyze that, how much time this algorithm would take? Because if, let's assume that n items are there into S, if I say that n items are there inside my set S, okay, if how many items I have, I am telling that if m dot S has n number of items, okay, then this for loop is executing for how many times? So let us, I think we should start from beginning. This step, order of one time, constant time. Second step, n item is there, and I'm going to have the, I'm going to do the sorting, therefore order of n log n time. Log n time I'm going to invest. This particular loop is executing n number of time, okay, because in all the items are considered one by one, however n plus 1, but that is order of n, okay. So it is going to take order of n time. What it is going to do, it is going to check whether that if I include that item into X, is it inside the I? Let's assume that it takes fn time. I'm not sure about this, that how much time it takes. Let's assume that it takes fn amount of time, and then this statement is executed only once, okay, order of one time, okay. So it takes order of one time. If it is like that, then I'm going to do that. So total amount of time is this plus this plus this number of time I'm going to execute this statement. So total time is going to be order of n log n plus n time multiplied by fn, okay, because this inside thing is n time, this inside thing is going to take n fn time, and therefore this is what the complexity of this particular algorithm is. So excellent algorithm. Yeah. Now we have to show that this algorithm is going to give you the right solution. We have to show that this algorithm gives you the right solution. Any questions on this? Well, first of all, at this particular slide, I want your questions. If you have any questions you have, please ask. Any questions? Utkarsh, any questions? Siddharth, any question? Whether this analysis is clear that this algorithm is going to take this much time. So we are going to show that this algorithm is going to be correct. So few things, one by one, I'm going to say that it is going to show the greedy choice property. Greedy choice property. That there is a choice which is the best at a moment, and I'm going to take that. Okay. So greedy choice is this, that inside, what is the greedy choice here? Into the set S, I have arranged the item into the decreasing order, and I am going to pick the first item. This was I was doing. Yeah, everybody? I was doing. So the first element I was selecting, first element of S I was selecting after the order. So this was my greedy choice. So I wanted to tell that if I pick this item, so definitely there would be a solution, there would be a right answer where this item would be there. Where multiple solutions are there. Na? Let's assume A, B, C, D, multiple solutions are there. I am telling, I am going to prove that if I am picking this, so I am sure that at least in the available solution, there would be at least one solution where this item would also be there. So I am done. Make sense? If I can show that this is my greedy choice, that I'm taking the first item. And what I wanted to tell you, I wanted to show you that into the final solution, at least there is one solution where this item would also be there. If I can show this, then I'm doing right. My logic is clear, everybody? Ikna? My logic is clear? Ruthvi? Harsh? Kudar, my logic is clear? Yes? Okay. So if you understand my logic, that what is my greedy choice is the selecting first item. And if I can show that there into the multiple solution are possible, but at least in one solution, this would also be there. If I can show this. Let me provide you the proof. So the proof is very simple. It goes in this way. Because this is the first item I'm talking about, let me call it X. Okay. So let me think that there is B. Let B be any non-empty optimal subset. Let's assume that it is an optimal set. B is an optimal set. And B does not contain X. Let me assume that B does not contain X. So I was telling that multiple solutions are possible, A, B, C, D, and there is some B, it does not contain X. Okay, so the first thing that no element of B has a weight greater than BX. All the element that B has, they all have the weight less than WX. Why? Why? Because S was sorted. S was sorted. First item was X, and you have selected Y. Y must come after this. Okay. If into the X, if you are not taking X, you would be taking something Y. If you are not taking X, then you would be taking something Y, and that would be your maximum item because you have not selected X. This line is clear. Yes. Everybody, please write yes or no. I need your support. Yeah. So this line is clear. That B would have something, okay. Okay, so now we have the scenario that A has X and B has Y, okay. Some more items are also there. I'm constructing X, okay. So in the A I have X and B has the first, B is, we know that it is the right item. First item is Y, and then many items are there. Now you know that the size of A is actually less than size of B. So therefore you can find out an element of here, an element here, and put it here. Again, the size is smaller. You put the next item and put it here. You keep doing this until the size of A is equal to size of B. You can do it. Everybody okay with me that I can put all the items from here and there? Say yes. Yes. The A was constructed. Does it also belongs to I? Very interesting question. So Ayush, this question I'm not answering right now. I'm telling that if I'm just only talking about the greedy choice. Okay, your question would come later. We would also discuss that thing. Right now I'm talking about if I'm taking this first item, then it would be inside that solution only. Okay, so your question would come later. Okay, any question? Siddharth, yes, but isn't B maximal? So yes, B is maximal. Yeah, we know that B is maximal. So we have taken all the items from here to here. Now both have the same size. Till now everything is clear. A and B have the same size. Here A has a X and B has a Y. Okay, so what happens? All the items are there. So construct A by taking X and then items from B. This part is clear to everybody. Okay, this part is clear to everybody that I have constructed A. How I constructed A. Okay. When A and B are the same size, they are differing on only one item, that is a Y belongs to B. All items are the same. So if I want to see that what is the weight of A, it is the weight of B. Into the weight of B, you remove the, if I want to find out what is the weight of A, I can say that into the B, I can remove this particular thing and add this particular X. I can remove the Y and add the X. By this, I can find out this. But we know that this particular quantity, by plus this negative quantity, if I say that W of X minus W of Y, if I consider this, we know that the W was actually, because of this logic, we have just seen that Y has the smaller value. So therefore, this value is going to be positive. So this complete thing is actually negative. Therefore, weight of A is actually greater than weight of B. But we were thinking that A was optimal. We were thinking that B was optimal. Okay, we were thinking that optimal set B was an optimal set. So it means that it is a contradiction. Contradiction of what? Of our assumption. What assumption we have made? We have made this only assumption that B does not contain X. This is the only assumption that B, we started by this. We are saying that B does not contain X. B contains something Y. So any optimal set, now you can see that I was telling that out of multiple, at least one of them would be X, but it turns out that every would have the X. All the maximal sets, which are actually of the maximum size, but they are maximal also, they would contain X. Okay, this is what the proof is. Okay, sir, here the maximal means that the weight of the spanning tree is maximum. Yes, the value, summation of the weights is maximal. Okay. And as I told you that the same algorithm you can use to find out the minimize also. Okay, minimization also. We have discussed just now that if you change the weights, then definitely the things which are giving you the maximum is going to give you the minimum. The proofs are going to with respect to the maximum. So this is clear to everybody. Next thing, that matroid exhibit the greedy choice property. This is the same thing. Next thing actually that we want to discuss, that actually this was the question from Ayush. This was the question from Ayush. Look, your question comes. Let M is equal, there is a matroid, be any matroid. If X is an element of S, that is an extension of some independent subset A of S, then X is also an extension of the phi. That is the extension of some independent subset of X. Independent subset A of S. Then X is also an extension of phi. So essentially what I wanted to tell, that if you have something, if you have, if you, if something is tending to phi, means if you have, actually I wanted to tell that inside A, if lot of items are there, okay, if I pick any item X, and now this time I'm not talking about the maximum one, maximum one is this, but let me talk anything else. So if you are in confusion, let me tell it why. If I pick any other item, so I wanted to tell that this item also belongs independently into the system. Y is also belong inside the I. Make sense? I just wanted to tell that if, so no, what I wanted to tell, that if A is a maximal, okay, A is some independent subset, A is an independent subset of A, means what? A may be containing many item. Okay, let's assume A may be containing many item. Okay, X is there, Y is there, Z is there, multiple items. So till now we were talking about X is something that is a maximum. I'm telling that you pick any item from here, that particular item independently would also be inside the I. Make sense? Why? This is, the proof is very simple. It says that since X is an extension of A, here in this write-up it is written X. So I was just giving this thing. Since you know that this thing is inside the thing, we can say that that all the subsets of A are also inside I. And you know that this Z is a subset of A. Okay, this is going to be I because Z is a subset of A. Make sense? Make sense? Because it's a subset of that. Okay. Okay. This part is clear. Very, very simple thing. You need not to get confused. I just wanted to tell you this thing, that if there is something that is inside I, so if you pick any of the item which is there, if X is inside A, so you can say that X is actually subset of A, therefore X, therefore, what I wrote here, okay, here's a countdown, sorry. So what I was telling, that A is inside I, it means, and let's assume that X belongs to A, then I can say that X is a subset of A, and all the subsets are inside I, so therefore this X is inside I. That's it. If X is inside this, then X actually extends phi. X extends phi. Make sense? X extends phi. Because phi, if phi is added X, then it becomes this. So this is what the proof is. Next line is this, that and for anything that is actually, and the contrapositive statement of the above is this, that if anything is not extending phi, then it is not extending any other thing. Then it is not extending anything. If X is an element of S such that X is not extension of the phi, then X is not an extension of any independent subset of S. So the opposite is this, that if something is not extending phi, means it is not existence. If something is not extending I, means it is not existence, it is not there inside the I, then it is not a part of anything else. Any independent set, it's not a part of any independent set. Okay, so it essentially means that if anything that you reject, actually it means that if any element that the GD passes over, means rejects and don't take it initially because they are not extension of the phi, because they are not existing independently, they are not there into the independent set, that then that can be forgotten since they can never be useful. Okay, so this is an important thing, that if there is something, some X is there, then you can take it inside. If something is not there, it is not possible that later point of time you can include inside the A. Okay, then comes a very interesting property that tells that the matroids exhibit the optimal substructure problem. What is the optimal substructure? Means the big problem that you are going to solve, use that thing, solve a particular thing, and now the smaller problem of the same type actually originates. how can create the smaller size problem, so a solution. So here actually says that, very simple, let x be the first element of S chosen by greedy. Okay, so S has a lot of item, and you have chosen the first item, and you have placed into where, into the set, your set A. Okay, so it says that you create another set. Now initially what was in your disposal, you have S and I. Now I am telling that when you have chosen this particular item, you create S dash and I dash. You create an I dash, two different sets, and solve the problem on this S dash and I dash, where S dash and I dash are of the smaller size. Make sense? This part is clear? That you have M, S, I, okay, S and I you have. I am telling that when you pick this particular item, you create a smaller stent by taking S dash and I dash, and you solve the same thing over in this particular set. How to create this S dash? S dash is this, that for all the Y's which are there inside the S, if X, Y is inside the I, then you take those Y's. Okay. So you go and see inside the I, who are the other things which can be attached to this particular X. You take only those things into this particular S. What is the I? And how can I change the I dash? I dash? I dash is equal to, you take S minus I. You take S minus I and take all those subsets which are there inside the I. That's it. Because now your S has changed. One item is removed from that because you had picked that particular item. So you say that for all other items which are there, from which such that if you connect the X with them, then they are inside the I. Once again, let me tell you that what I told you. So I told you that item with which if you connect X, and this B is inside S minus X, you see that they are inside the I. So essentially, all the connections with the X are actually going to be preserved, and the things which are not connected, we can neglect them. There is a line Siddhant in writing, sir, but in the case of tree, each is can exist independently, and greedy algorithm still passes over some of the edges. You are all right, but the question is this, that I am going to give you the method how to create the optimal substructure. Use this method to create the optimal substructure. Make sense? Here I am telling that the things which are not going to be hand in hand with my X, I am going to neglect them. This particular construction of S dash says that the things which are not going to be good with my X, I am going to neglect this. Okay? Okay, Siddharth. So I hope it is clear. Okay. So in this way, this is because that A dash is equal to, and now you find out this is the smaller portion, and you find out the solution, optimal solution A dash over here, and then you can build the complete solution by saying that A dash union of X, and this is your final solution. Make sense? So this is how you actually create the optimal substructure, and this is also the same kind of smaller size problem, and then you can solve that and find out the solution. Now we are going to discuss the correctness of the greedy algorithm. Okay, so we want to say that if you have a MSI as a weighted matroid, then greedy returns the optimal subset. So this is what my thing is, my claim is, yeah, I'm going to create the optimal subset out of that. So what is the point? Three points I wanted to make. The first point, that if greedy algorithm passes over anything, if my algorithm is not selecting anything, it passes over, then it is liable to be passed, because later it can never be useful. later it can never be useful. This is the line, okay? This is the line that we have seen the proof. Once the greedy algorithm select the first element x, the algorithm does not error by adding x to A, since there exists an optimal subset containing x. So if it picks anything here we have proved that if it picks anything, it is right. Okay, the second thing, whatever you are picking right, whatever you are picking right, whatever you are leaving right, they will never be used. Okay, so finally the remaining problem is one of finding an optimal subset of the matroid M dash. So when you pick one item, after that your problem actually reduces to the smaller set, as we have done here. You can reformulate the problem and you can solve this and just find out one item from here, and then again you can do the same thing. So going into the incremental way in this way, so what it tells that if you have graphical matroid M, then you created from M to M dash and you picked the item X, then from M dash to M double dash and you picked another item Y, M double dash to M triple dash you picked the item Z, and you keep on doing until all the items are exhausted. This construction makes sure, these properties make sure that whenever you are actually neglecting a particular item, that item would never be useful, and whatever you are selecting is actually right. And that's why the greedy algorithm, this greedy algorithm that we have just talked about, is correct. Make sense? So that's all for today. Thank you very much. Thank you for joining.